The storyline continues about 2 hours after the first film finished. Iko's character Rama is out of that building and he has a box of tapes given to him by Andy, his brother.
Ini kuncinya. Ini akan nunjukin siapa aja yang masuk dalam daftar hitam. Gak semua orang yang lo kenal itu busuk, Ram. Lo kasih ke Bu Nawar. Dia orang yang baik.
We start our story off with Rama taking this box of tapes to like a secret rendezvous point to meet up with Bu Nawar, who is the leader of an anti-corruption task force.
Gua mau lu gabung sama tim gue. Divisi kita memang kecil, tapi ada alasannya kenapa kecil. Kepercayaan.
Rama finds out that his life is at stake because of what he did in that building. That there are higher elements, both in the mafia world and also in the corrupt side of the police, that are going to come after him now and try to find him and try to kind of take him out because they don't know how much he knows and what threat he poses to them.
Kita akan cari.
Gua akan beresin semua. Harus.
So we have two rival families. We have the Japanese side and we have the Indonesian side. They're both at the high end. And then right in the middle, you have this lower rung guy called Bujo, played by Alex Abad. And he's someone who's kind of come from nothing. He had no one to support him at all. He's kind of like clawed his way up and risen through the ranks.
Iya, yang merubah, yang membuat semua karakter-karakter itu ketemu. Bejonya sendiri, dia bicaranya tenang, tidak terlalu menunjukkan emosinya. Sempat lepas 1, 2, 3 kali bagian, cuman dia lebih fokus. Dan kefokusan itu, ketenangan itu adalah karakternya Bejo.
Aku berperan sebagai Ucho, karakternya sangat sadis. Ada begitu banyak ambisi yang terpendam di dalam dirinya dia sampai akhirnya keluar dan juga melihat manusia tuh, semua manusia tuh di bawah dia ibaratnya begitu.
Kalau sekarang kita diam, kita pasti injek-injek.
There's a lot more characters in this movie and there's a lot more sort of strands of the plot and it's about how each sort of individual strand and each individual character will have an effect on the other storylines and then how they all kind of come together and just clash at the end of the movie. Even when there's a fight scene going on, it's to do with the plot. So like the fight scene continues the story going forward. So in the prison riot, like that we shot in Gombong, there's like 3 different elements in that fight scene. There's paranoia, first of all, from Iko's character when he thinks he's gonna get attacked. Then there's the realization that they're not after him, but they're after the person that he needs to get close to. And if that person gets killed, then his mission is over. And then he's just gonna rot in prison. And if he rots in prison, he's fucked. Then he has to become a bodyguard, then he has to protect. So like that's all wrapped up in one fight scene. And it's like this plot there, this character there, there's like this motivation and everything else.
Nasibnya rombongan lu lumayan sih.
Mereka, gue juga harus melakukan adaptasi, bisa saling mengisi kekosongan untuk kepentingan scene.
Di sini jauh lebih dalam dengan durasi yang 150 menit dibanding Dread yang 100 menit. Bagaimana Iko dan banyak pemain lainnya berdialog, berekspresi, membawakan karakter. Para pemain juga di sini luar biasa, ada Tio Pakusadewo dengan karakter bangun yang begitu keras, singa tua yang letih. Ada lagi Roy Martin, banyak sekali senior-senior kita kumpulin di sini. Mereka sangat antusias ingin bergabung dan ingin berperan di dalam film ini.
Cukup. Semuanya harus berhenti sekarang.
I always saw it more like an ensemble piece. So I knew I needed really good actors for all of the roles. I knew I needed like really sort of solid, recognizable faces in the Indonesian film industry, but then also to bring in some guys from outside, like from the casting in Japan.
Japanese yakuza was in the past. Bushino was a lot of created when he played yakuza, but he played it abroad and played it for a foreign director.
It's a lot more drama this time than the first movie, but deep down the action's gonna be a lot bigger. We're expanding the scale of this, expanding the scope.
Koreografi kita desain itu sudah dari sejak setelah merantau.
Kan
kami sangat-sangat salut dengan sutradara Gareth Evans yang dia bisa mengkolaborasikan teknik bela diri pencaksilat dengan semua bentuk dan emosi dari setiap teknik yang kami berikan, yang kami sajikan dengan lokasi yang sama sekali di luar dugaan kami.
Karakter Hammer Girl itu membutuhkan skill fighting yang cukup tinggi gitu. Ada kicknya, ada maksudnya dan di sini juga lawan Hammer Girl adalah fighter beneran yang mereka juga sudah fighting dari mungkin usianya masih muda.
Jumlah koreo sendiri sekitar 19 scene fighting. Tingkat kesulitan teknik-teknik fighting sendiri di Brandal ini memang kami siapkan memang lebih dari The Raid.
Ya 1-2 menit lah, kedengerannya pendek. Tapi kalau dalam istilah fighting itu panjang sekali.
Ini sequelnya, kita kasih tantangan atau adegan-adegan yang belum muncul di dua seri sebelumnya. Misalnya seperti kejar-kejaran mobil, itu kita garap sangat serius.
Total ada sekitar 10 mobil sedan mewah.
This one already like conquered.
Adegan ini sangat sulit dan ini sangat bahaya gitu. Resikonya adalah nyawa. Tadi kita dapat tim Bruce Lau dari Hong Kong.
Kami buat beberapa toba untuk berlatih lah. Buat beberapa platform yang di bawah untuk orang menyerang saat itu. 保护跟安全啊，或是做了很多底座在切底下，我能拎到周边能放的摄影机啊，也在切里面做了防护架，在翻切的时候比较安全的。Semua
adegan, alhamdulillah saya lakukan sendiri. Fighting dalam mobil, tabrak-tabrak mobil gitu kan yang lebih agresif. Latihannya dari gue loncat mobil ke mobil lain, itu langsung di set. Tapi sebelum kita take, dilihat dulu jaraknya seperti apa, speednya seperti apa, itu udah diperhitungkan oleh tim Bruce Lau.
We're moving along at 60 miles an hour with the car. We're keeping the camera feeling very handheld. Action! We have a camera pass, so the camera's in one car and we're passing it physically to another car, traveling at 50. So two operators but one camera, and we'd start the movement and pass to the other operator. Those kind of give me the most kick because they're really simple tricks, but they just work really well. The camera's always moving, but it's realistic movement.
Tahu jalan utama di Jakarta siang hari work days hari kerja dan jalannya harus minimal 3 lane 3 jalur 4 jalur ada Kemayoran, Senayan, kemudian kita juga tutup di SCBD, kemudian ada di Blok M. Ini tantangan yang lain lagi karena persis di depan terminal bis Blok M, aktivitasnya setiap hari ribuan orang naik turun bis, ratusan bis keluar masuk, itu harus kita tutup dari jam 6 pagi sampai 6 sore. Sangat sulit. Ya itu film, bagaimana tantangan memberikan ke penonton hal yang tidak mungkin tapi bisa kita lakukan. Itu bisa bikin surprise buat penonton. Untuk lokasi dibanding dengan film-film sebelumnya ini yang terbanyak, baik outdoor maupun studio.
Toilet ini kita bikin nggak biasa karena di sini banyak koreo. Ini ada engsel, bisa geser.
Action.
Gimana caranya kata Gareth biar bisa lebih cepet movable-nya? Akhirnya gue bikin model buka tutup engsel gitu dan semuanya ada jumlahnya 4 kubikel. Kalau untuk scene fighting-nya kita bikin agak lebih besar dikit.
Semua scene totally different, sangat berbeda satu sama lain. Wide, extreme wide, malah landscape yang nggak ditemuin di kota besar. Ada tebu, penjara juga yang secara view luar biasa.
Huge set, you can see amazing location in Gombong. When as soon as we saw it, we knew immediately we wanted to use this place because of the structure, the layout. Like I haven't seen anything like this before, and I think figured it'd be really interesting for audiences to see something like this.
Tiap-tiap jendelanya kita coverin semua dengan teralis-teralis, semuanya kita coverin dengan teralis. Terus di pinggir-pinggirnya kita bikin shelter-shelter. Panjangnya satu shelter ini tiap sisinya ada 25 meter dengan lebar 2,5 meter.
Lumpur setinggi mata kaki, kemudian ini semua nanti dibikin hujan sederas-derasnya rata. Sementara tantangan kita adalah matahari di Indonesia yang selalu naik turun, makanya kita bikin silk. Ini 20 kali 50 kali 3, jadi gede banget ini. Bentuknya seperti pentagon ini, seperti kolosium gladiator, cocok banget sama pertarungan prison riot yang benar-benar terkurung di dalamnya.
Action! Cut, cut, cut!
Every department can be able to kind of like monitor things. I mean, like obviously like the DOPs that are operating, so they're seeing everything live. I was blown away by the setup and blown away by the system and realizing how easy it was to be able to kind of monitor the footage and also be able to edit really quickly. With the Q-Tech system that he has, like literally the moment I've called cut on something, if I'm sort of like, oh, maybe that take is okay, I can check it immediately. It's in my hard drive. So I can just drop it straight in, chop, 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 and then play with it. And I know already now, okay, that take was good, next shot. Or that take is shit, let's go again. So it's the speed of it that I really love. When I do that editing on location, first and foremost, the main reason to do it is to know that I have my shots. It's to know that I have that action scene working before I leave that location. We're not going to have to come back and shoot extra stuff because I fucked up and didn't realize I didn't have it in the first place. But the second part, and this is like almost equally as important, is that thing of like, when we shoot these films, they're hard, they're stressful. Everyone's anxiety levels start to rise as production goes on. And this is a long production, this is like 6-7 months. So when you're forced to spend that much time with the same people, your brains are about to explode after a while. So the benefit of doing those edits is that I can show people cuts, I can show people, oh, hey, you know how shitty the car chase stress is right now? How hard it is, how miserable it is, how much time we're losing every day? Okay, well, this is the first 4 days of shooting. This is the edit of that footage. Take a look at it. Like, it's working. What we're doing is good. It's hard, but it's good. And if we just keep working at it, if we keep going at it, it'll get better and it'll look better and it's gonna be better. And so it kind of works as this morale booster for all the crew then and the cast. They can see that, you know, all the misery and the mayhem is worthwhile.
Ya, di sini kita menggunakan hampir sekitar 60 tipe jenis senjata. Begitu bervariasi, jauh lebih banyak dari Dread 1 dulu. Kemudian yang menggunakan juga jauh lebih banyak. Dari Dread 1 hanya pasukan khusus dengan gangster, sementara di sini gangsternya jauh lebih lebar lagi.
Seorang yang mungkin bukan dunianya dari segi hiruk pikuk dunia gemerlap, tapi dia cukup punya hubungan dengan dunia malam sebagai seorang yang katakanlah seorang pembunuh.
Kerjaan ini pilihan kamu?
Yang lama untuk mempersiapkannya sih prakoso. Warna rambut kita rubah, kita tambahin jenggot, kita bikin dia kelihatan lebih tua, kita bikin dia kelihatan lebih kasihan. Kita ingin orang tuh ada simpati sama prakoso meskipun dia pembunuh bayaran.
Action!
Veranda, we kind of wanted to go for a bigger, more cinematic look.
We have moments where we use very composed camera movements. So it's kind of a combination of slow dolly shots, big wide shots, and then we go into the fight where it's obviously hand to hand. So we go back on the figurehead for those.
untuk adegan balap mobil gitu ya, memang kamera movement-nya jauh lebih liar dari itu. Ada kamera yang menggunakan alat berat. Contohnya pakai 4 crane besar, terus kamera kita gantung di atas. Kita nge-set angle aja kita perlu ngeblok jalan dengan banyak koordinasi.
Nah, tolong bantuannya juga bahwa nanti mobil-mobil yang keluar ini harus teratur. Tidak ada penumpukan di tengah-tengah sini, Bapak.
We kind of wanted most of the characters to have a different look about them, so there's a different color feel. So Bejo, for example, we're using lots of reds. When we go into the kitchen with the assassin, it's very cold and clean and white.
Desainnya dari permintaan director. Director minta setiap scene, setiap lokasi kita punya beberapa konsep warna yang beda-beda. Tidak semua dibikin flat, tidak semua dibikin sama.
It's a mix of different styles. So, like, there'll be certain scenes that call for that kind of chaos. There's certain scenes where we establish traditional elements. So, like, we have a scene with like a Rayog performance. So we decided to use some of the source material, audio from the performance, but then fuse it with like a dramatic score that kind of like gives it more tempo and keeps pushing the scene forward. We have Indonesian elements, we have Indonesian instruments, we have electronic score, we have that sort of like crazy high octane stuff as well. But then mixed in with all of that, we have these real nice sort of like emotional beats where we sort of introduce like strings and things like that then as well. So it's a whole collage of different styles, but like with one central theme that kind of hangs everything together then.
Kita harus bisa menggabungkan segi tradisional yang tarian reog itu dengan scoring kita sendiri.
Lebih ke apa ya, adrenalin dari percussion based sih, jadi lebih banyak variasi-variasi perkusi yang terjadi. Yeah.
One reason why I love scoring film is because all the answers are in the film. You're never at a point in the scoring process where you're going, I have no idea what to do, because you have this really great guide, which is the film and the director, and really bring across the character of the film, and to really reach out and grab the audience and make them feel even more a part and more enthralled in the picture.
Alhamdulillah, kita mendapat jaringan distribusi yang sangat baik, sangat positif, di mana distribusi di Indonesia tetap kami sendiri yang jalankan, Merantau Film, di Jepang oleh Kadokawa Pictures, di Amerika dan beberapa wilayah lain yang dipegang sama Sony Pictures, itu dirilis sama Sony Pictures.
Basically, one of the great things about this film is that it already has an audience. You know, the first film did a great job of breaking in and breaking an audience and being able to be exposed as large and wide as it has. It now has a following. A lot of people are still discovering the movie, and they're going to continue to discover it up until this film is released. And so this one has a great opportunity. And Gareth has some really exciting tricks in for people, and I think people are going to expect one thing and get another in a really exciting way. And so I think this film, first and foremost, it's going to be a perfect expansion in terms of story and action, and it elevates the bar in terms of action in a serious way. I think people will be very happy to see what he's been able to do here.
Every film is like a different challenge, and you make tons of mistakes off everything you do, and we made loads of mistakes on Merantau, made loads of mistakes on The Raid, and the goal is to just learn from each of them and try to kind of not make those mistakes again, and better yourself as a filmmaker, and better yourself as a crew, and better yourself as a talent.
Bisa dilihat, semua tetap kita bawa silat, agresif silat.
Ditontonnya itu seperti beneran ya.
Like, it's never gonna be for everyone. Whoever wants to watch it and enjoys it, that's great. And that's all you can really hope for.
Kalau film Indonesia separuh aja semangatnya seperti ini,
ketelitian mereka film Indonesia kan sangat bagus.
Begitu banyak fighter yang terlibat di sini. Ternyata mereka juara nasional, ada yang medali emas, ada dari PON, SEA Games, dan seterusnya. Ini membuat kita wow, begitu begitu dahsyatnya ini, dan ketika film ini jadi, semoga bisa jadi kebanggaan kita semua.